stand against us. He's that rock and we're the man. He has worlds at his command. We cannot fall with his mighty arms around us. His word is stronger than the sharpest sword. Though heavy grow the heart, stumbling through a world so dark, though Armageddon lie ahead, cast away the fear and dread. If God be for us, who can stand against us? We are marching in the army of the Lord. In this world of fear and doubt, where confusion stalks about, let us not be scattered, but unite as one. It's time for righteous men to rise, as for kindness to fight. Stand united, that His will on earth be done. If God be for us, who can stand against us? He's that rock and weary man. He has worlds at His command. We cannot fall with His mighty arms around us. His word is stronger than the sharpest sword. Though heavy grow the heart, stumbling through a world so dark, though Armageddon lie ahead, cast away the fear and dread. If God be for us, who can stand against us? We are marching in the army of the Lord. We are marching in the army of the Lord.
Well, good morning, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to Mid-Morning Manna. What a joy it is to be with you today on this Friday, and it's a beautiful day, and I'm thanking the Lord for it, and again, kind of a pleasant day. And now the weekend's coming, and I hear you folks in the greater Louisville area are supposed to be having some real activities going on Saturday, and praying for that whole situation, that God will just work in miraculous ways. You know, God has a way of intervening when God's people pray. And I want to challenge you, let's be prayer warriors. Let's pray God will just do something phenomenal that will all just almost cause us to have belly laughs, that God will get a victory in these matters. And we can't just depend on government, that's for sure. And you can't depend on politicians. And you can't depend on fate. And you can't depend on the devil's crowd. So let's just ask God to intervene. Let's make ourselves available to Him to say, Lord, have your way, have your will. And who knows, maybe there'll be a hurricane come through town and or something else. Who knows what might happen? Maybe we'll have the biggest thunderstorm, or maybe we'll have a snowstorm. Who knows? But ask God to intervene in that thing. Well, we're talking about this week, and this is Friday, this is the last day, talking about how to read your Bible. And boy, that's an important thing. Everybody ought to be a Bible reader. And even if you say, well, preacher, I can't read that well, or I can't see that well, or that kind of thing, well, then get it on your phone or on your other device, on your iPad or whatever you have, and download it. If you don't have that, if you have an old cassette player, then get the old Alexander Scorby tapes. Do something. You can do it. Or you can make an excuse for why you can't do it. You can talk about how you're too busy, that you have 2-hour travel time to work, to and from work. Well, then get it and play it on your CD player in your car while you're traveling back and forth to work. Lethargy finds an excuse, but love finds a way. Let's get busy and do what we know God wants us to do. Our memory verse this week has been 1 Timothy chapter 4, verse 13. I hope you've written it down. I hope you've memorized it or that you're working on it. And it says in 1 Timothy 4, 13, till I come, give attendance to reading, to exhortation, to doctrine. Get the Word of God in your life. It's just a reminder to you to get the Word of God in your life. And so how to read the Bible. We talked about just a very quick review. Don't have time to get, if I give you a whole review every time, we won't make it through. But number one, read the Bible confidently. Number two, read the Bible thoughtfully. Number three, read the Bible consistently. Number four, read the Bible thoroughly. Number five, read the Bible unselfishly. Number six, read it discriminately. Number seven, read it intelligently. And then we come to Friday, and I'll give you the last two. Now, number eight, read the Bible, hopefully. Oh, that was the last one yesterday. I'm sorry. I'm getting behind myself. Sometimes I get ahead of myself, sometimes I get behind myself. Sometimes we have mid-morning manna, and sometimes we have mid-morning madness. You never know. So tune in. You'll be amazed. As a matter of fact, this coming week, I think I'm going to try to get you to find the person winking and to try to find the person, try to find the whale. I'll tell you more about that later. Anyway, read the Bible, number 9, and it's the first one of the day. We've got 9 and 10, and that closes it out. Number 9, read the Bible obediently. My, how we need to be obedient Christians reading the Word of God. And listen to this. I got several verses on this thing of reading the Bible obediently. You see, if you're not reading the Bible, number one, you're being disobedient right there. But then the Bible, as you read it, it'll give you many instructions and guidelines and helps for your life. And you ought to say, as God reveals something to me, I'm going to give it my best effort to be obedient to God, to let Him help me. One of the things I say at North Harrison Baptist Church, I say it often, every now and then, every month or so, I'll mention that when you enter that back door coming into the church, you're coming into a no-judgment zone, that there's nobody in this room, including the pastor, who has the authority to judge you, and we don't have the standing. We're not the judge, but God is the judge. So my job is to give out the Word of God. Brother Shane's job is to give out the Word of God. And your job, as you hear the Word of God, is to allow God to be your judge and then follow Him. Do what God tells you to do. And that's a very important thing. So read the Bible obediently. Let me give you a few verses here about this matter of obedience. In Jeremiah chapter 7, verse 23, "But this thing commanded I them, saying, Obey my voice, and I will be your God, and ye shall be my people, and walk ye in all the ways that I have commanded you, that it may be well unto you." Isn't that something? He said, walk in all the ways that I have commanded you. So God has given some commands, and he's telling through Jeremiah to his people, God said, I'm not just speaking to you so I can hear my voice. I'm speaking to you because I want you to be available to do some things, to accomplish some things for my glory. Do what I've commanded. Jeremiah chapter 26, verse 13. "Therefore now, amend your ways and your doings and obey the voice of the Lord your God, and the Lord will repent him of the evil that he hath pronounced against you." Isn't that something? Amend your ways and your doings and obey the voice of the Lord. Well, it couldn't be any more straightforward than that. We talk about obeying, reading the Bible obediently with a heart that says, if God will show me something that is His will for my life or a command to all of God's people, something we ought to be doing on a regular basis, I want to do it. And then in Acts chapter 5, verse 29, "Then Peter and the other apostles answered and said, We ought to obey God rather than men." By the way, when someone tells you something you can't do and God said, I want you to do it, who are you going to obey? You're going to obey God or are you going to obey man? You know, there could be a time where, like in other nations and other times and other generations and other places in communist countries, they ban the Bible. They tell everybody, you got to get rid of your Bible. You got to turn in your Bibles. They burn the Bibles, burn the book. Are you going to turn yours in? You're going to give it up? You know, there's a lot of people that want to say in America that the Bible is a hate book, and that it's full of hatred and bias, and by the way, it is biased towards God and towards Jesus Christ and towards getting folks saved and that sort of thing. But he said, let me read it again. Jeremiah said, in Acts chapter 5 verse 8, said, "Then Peter and the other apostles answered and said, We ought to obey God rather than men." So make up your mind as you read the scriptures. Are you going to obey the Word of God? Are you going to allow God to work through your life? Listen, you want to be a growing Christian? The way you grow is you obey. the way a child learns to do things, or on the job when you're maybe an apprentice or some other thing. The way you grow is not just, I'm going to go in there and do what I want to do. I'm going to do it my way. Nobody's going to tell me what to do. No, you listen to those who are training you, those who are raising you, those who have responsibility for you. You listen to their instruction. You try to obey. You go to school and the teacher gives you certain instructions, tells you maybe where to sit and when not to talk, when you can talk, or when you go to the restroom or whatever else. And you say, no, nobody's going to tell me what to do. I'm going to do it my way. You know, you're going to end up in the principal's office. You might end up getting kicked out of school. Yes, we learn to obey the human elements. And God said, I just want you to trust me enough to believe me and to obey me. And I hope that you will. And again, Peter and the other apostles answered and said, we ought to obey God rather than men. And then Romans 6:17, but God be thanked. This is Paul writing to the church there at Rome. And he said, but God be thanked that ye were servants of sin, but ye have obeyed from the heart that form of doctrine which was delivered unto you. He said, at one point in your life, you were a servant of sin. You say, how does a person serve sin? Well, they get hooked on things and they can't quit. And they become a servant to it. They become, everybody's against slavery. I'm against slavery. And everybody I know is, I don't know anybody that's pro-slavery. Everybody's against slavery. It's still going on in many places in the world, but everybody's against it. But at the same time, we enslave ourselves to the elements of this world. People are enslaved to to smoking and to drinking or to overeating or to sexual pleasures or to other things. All these kind of things, people get addicted to these things and they become a servant to it, and it drives them. And oh, what a terrible thing. In many cases, it ends up in lives of that are destroyed, premature deaths, going to prison, who knows what else. And so I'm just challenging you today that you ask God to help you, that even though maybe at one point in your life you were a slave to sin, thank you that God has delivered you and given you the opportunity to be obedient to him. So that's point number 9, read your Bible obediently. And then the last one, read the Bible saved. Boy, that's important. Read the Bible saved. If you're watching, listening today, and you've never been saved, then my friend, you need to get a relationship with the Word of God. You need to get a relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. You need to become a child of God. You need to be born again. And that reading the Bible as a lost person is not going to change your life unless you believe it and receive it and invite Jesus Christ into your life, put your trust in him. Then, as you read the Bible, it will mean so much more to you. Listen to what he said in 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 14. It says, but the natural man, that's the unsaved man, the natural man receiveth not the things of the Spirit of God, for they are foolishness unto him. Neither can he know them, because they are spiritually discerned. If you're not saved, you can read the Bible till the cows come home, but you still won't really get the full input that God wants you to get. You won't get the impact. You won't get the understanding. It'll be nonsense to you. It'll just raise more questions than answers. But the spiritual man, the man that's been born again, born of the Spirit of God, not the natural man, but the new man, the man that's been born again, when he reads the Word of God, then he has Christ in him, the Holy Spirit lives in him, God, the Heavenly Father is working in his life, and the Word of God comes alive. All of a sudden, you'll be reading through, and you think, well, I'm still not getting anything, and then suddenly, I know this is not literally, but like a verse just jumps off the page, and you say, wow, that was meant for me. And God gives you something that will help you, that will strengthen you, that will encourage you, that will bless you, that will motivate you. And so you have to read the Bible saved. If you're not saved, then you're not going to get what God intended for you to get from his Word. And by the way, it's by his Word that we get saved to begin with. When we read the Word of God, realize that we're sinners, because the Bible says we've all sinned and come short of the glory of God. Realize that sin has a penalty. The wages of sin is death, not just physical death. We all face that. It's appointed unto man once to die. After that, the judgment. But spiritual death, The Bible says death and hell were cast into the lake of fire. This is the second death. So we're sinners, and what we deserve is the second death, being separated from God forever in a place that Jesus called hell. And so we need, number one, we're sinners. Number two, there's a penalty for sin. Number three, God sent his son to pay that penalty in our behalf. John 3:16, for God so loved you, God so loved the world, that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Now, folks, I'm telling you, we're sinners. We deserve hell. I ought to be in hell already. But God loved me. And one day I heard the word of God. I heard how to be saved. I heard these verses that I'm sharing with you right now. And I went home that day and I prayed. Well, I was alone in my room and prayed and asked the Lord to come into my heart. And the Lord saved me. I was a 9-year-old boy when that happened. But I know that I'm on my way to heaven. I know that I'm saved. I can remember that conviction in my heart of when I heard those verses, knowing that I was not saved and wanting to get saved and doing what I heard that I needed to do to get saved and called on the Lord. So we're sinners. There's a payment for sin. God loved us, sent his son Jesus to make that payment on our behalf. That's why we celebrate Easter and the death and the burial and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. So he paid that debt on our behalf. You say, well, then what's our part? If the debt's been paid, what's the big deal? Well, you got to tell God you want that payment applied to your account. The Bible says, whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Understanding that you're a sinner, you don't deserve heaven, God loves you, he wants to save you, he wants to forgive you, and he said, if you'll call on me, believing those facts, I'm willing to come into your life to be your Savior, take you to heaven when you die, giving you a life that's a little more heavenly right here on this old cruel earth. And so how important it is that you know the Savior. If you don't have that down in your heart and in your mind, before we go off here today, I'm going to lead in a prayer, and I hope you'll pray it with me and invite Jesus Christ into your life. 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 15, the Bible, here's again Paul writing to young Timothy, the preacher boy, and he said that from a child thou hast known the holy scriptures, which are able to make thee wise unto salvation through faith in Jesus Christ. So read the Bible saved. Make sure that you're saved. Then the Bible comes alive to you. It means so much more. You get in there and start reading through the Gospel of John, and boy, the light just comes on. It'll make all the difference in the world to you. And I hope you'll do it. So right now, right where you are, right there, if you're not sure of heaven, would you just humble your heart just a moment and just repeat these words in your heart as I pray this and lead you in this simple prayer, and ask Jesus to be your Savior. And would you do it right now? Just pray something like this. Dear Lord Jesus, I know that I am a sinner. I know that you died for my sins on that cross and paid my sin debt. And right now, Lord Jesus, the best I know how, I'm asking you to be my Savior. Come into my life, Lord Jesus. Forgive my sins. Take me to heaven when I die. Give me the courage to live for you here. And I ask these blessings in Jesus' name, amen. Now, maybe you know someone that needs that message. Why don't you send this today's mid-morning manna to them on Messenger, or just share it and let it go to everybody on your friend list. And let's help somebody else today. You say, well, preacher, I'm already saved, I've already settled all that, and I already have a good relationship with God's word. Well, good, share it with others. Don't be ashamed. Come on out of the closet, let folks know, send it out. Well, God bless you. Thank you for listening today. We're going to go off with another song, and if I can be of any service to you, get in touch. God bless.
Though it's hard to see it now, you feel you're walking but he is there, no doubt. When the storm around you rages and you're tossed to and fro, when you're faced with life's decisions and not sure which way to go, stand still and let God move. Standing still
when the enemies surround you and the walls are closing in, when the tide is swiftly rising and you wonder where he's been. Friend, there never was a moment that his arms weren't reaching out. You can rest assured and be secure, God is moving right now. Stand still and let God move.